from Red Curtain Addict, and I'm so excited to see you all tonight for our Behind the Curtain series, where together we will meet incredible artists, see exclusive concerts, and connect with each other, which we are art enthusiasts. Tonight, I'm really excited to be joined by Matt Young, who is a violist for the San Francisco Symphony. For all those that may not know this, I actually worked for the San Francisco Symphony before Red Curtain Addict. It was a dream of mine to work for this incredible orchestra coming from Tulsa to the Bay Area. And actually, Matt has a similar story, which is coming from Kentucky to the Bay Area to work at the San Francisco in the orchestra. But I want to introduce you to him personally, get to know him. But before we do, I want you to see this special clip that was created about Matt so we can hear his story that was made by the San Francisco Symphony. Let's take a look.
There's a pop psychology notion that if you do something for 10,000 hours, you'll be good at it. Millions of hours have been put together on the stage of Davies Hall. And it's just awe-inspiring to be in the middle of that and to learn from that daily. Growing up on a sixth generation family farm in rural Kentucky was amazing. We got to ride horses, play with friends. When I was driving tractors and combines, I got to listen to broadcast recordings of the great orchestras, including the San Francisco Symphony. It left a lasting impression hearing that kind of power come through, even on a John Deere tractor radio.
I just love that story. It's so great to see how he came about the viola and from the tractor to the Bay Area. I'm so excited to welcome Matt from the San Francisco Symphony. Welcome, Matt.
Hi, Carrie. Nice to see you again.
It's good to see you. So you are actually at home right now, right? It looks like you're in your living room.
Yes.
Very nice. I see the San Francisco Golden Gate Bridge behind you there.
Right. Yes. Yeah, I'm a fan of the Bay Area.
Oh, yeah. Me too. So cool to connect with you today. I'm really excited to kind of hear more about your story around being in the Bay Area and the San Francisco Symphony. Actually, tell us a little bit more about, you know, how long have you been playing for the San Francisco Symphony?
Yeah, I arrived here in 2012 after a long audition process and was welcomed with open arms. Everyone's been really wonderful for the past 8 years.
Wow, that's incredible. And you're right, there's so many amazing musicians in the orchestra from different walks of life, different ages. I'm sure it's a really fun group to be a part of.
Absolutely. I mean, that if I had to pick one favorite thing about being in the San Francisco Symphony, it is the human connection that we make, not with words, but with the vibrations in the air around us and the emotional impact that can bring. I'm surrounded by people who are way better than I am, and it makes me listen in different ways. You know, we've played Beethoven 50 times at least, and wow, every time I hear something new that I've never heard before, and that's because of these amazing artists that I get to be on stage with. It's a real joy. Yeah,
absolutely. You're constantly learning from each other, you know, from different, you know, backgrounds of music too, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
That's so cool. So I have a question for you. When you're not playing in the symphony and you're not practicing, which I know you do a lot, what is one of your favorite things to do in the city?
Well, I'm an amateur runner. I wouldn't say I'm fast, but I do run a lot so that I can eat a lot. Golden Gate Park's right down the hill from me, so I get over there a lot. And the Botanical Garden is a favorite place to hang out. They do an amazing job over there. The Parks and Rec service in San Francisco is something else. In a city with this density, to have that green space is just really rejuvenative.
Absolutely. I think that's one of the reasons why I love the city, is that you do have the city components, but you can quickly get into greens and parks and some of the beautiful trees that you see and things like that. So you kind of get the perfect blend.
Absolutely.
I completely agree. Okay, so let's talk about the San Francisco Symphony a little bit. So you guys are on pause for a bit, but I'm really excited to hear more about the up and coming season that we're all just kind of waiting for, because we definitely missed seeing you on stage. I was curious to tell us a little bit more about why this upcoming season is really special and maybe a few highlights that you're looking forward to.
Thanks, Carrie. Yeah, it's a special season coming up. Esa-Pekka Salonen, our music director designate, will be in his inaugural season with us. And he's got some really special projects planned. The one I'm looking forward to the most is his semi-stage production of Strauss's opera Elektra. It's basically a German romantic take on Greek mythology, and with an element of a horror movie thrown in there for the opera genre. It's going to be really something.
That sounds really fun. So it sounds like it's a more of a full production, right?
Yeah, semi-staged. Yeah.
Semi-staged. Okay, very, very cool. And, you know, I think that this is something I love, again, about the orchestra, is that you guys play a variety of pieces, whether that's from the semi-stage, you know, productions to the intimate recitals to one of my favorites is actually the movie nights. Let's talk about that a little bit. Tell us more, for all those who are listening that haven't been, tell us more about the movie night.
Absolutely. So that's quite a difficult task for the symphony orchestra, because the animal of what a symphony orchestra is we follow the interpretation and the hand gestures of the person on the podium with the stick, the conductor. Mm-hmm. And with a movie, we have to sort of superimpose the symphonic sound on what's already been recorded. So next year, we have the industry's best film conductor doing The Princess Bride, which is a childhood favorite of mine.
Oh my God.
So that's going to be fun. Sarah Hicks is her name, and she's an incredible maestro and can just, she really has a sixth sense for putting film and orchestra together. Another highlight would be MTT. Michael Tilson Thomas is coming back to do Mahler 1. So we're very excited about that.
Very, oh my gosh, so much fun things coming up. And speaking of these movie things, I think it's really interesting around, it really shows you what music does and how it affects you around these stories. I remember coming to the symphony and they actually took the music out of the film. We watched the film without the music, and then they played it again and symphony played along to it. And you can feel the anticipation that comes from the music that you didn't actually get just from the acting. So it's really interesting how the two really enhance each other, which is fun to watch.
Absolutely. And if you listen to John Williams with the Star Wars movies, there's a lot of Mahler and Holst in there as well. Yep. So we all learn from our predecessors, myself included, of course.
Oh. He's so incredible. It's really cool. I've actually seen John Williams conduct with you all. What a cool experience. Tell me about that. Like, what is it like to be under the you know, he's a conductor who wrote the music. That has to be pretty intense. You don't want to mess it up, right?
Absolutely. And you're playing for the man himself. I believe he's well into his 80s, but, you know, he wrote all of these iconic motives, including the Jaws motif.
Yes.
And to have him on the podium, and he has just such a very casual and genial way about him. He's very gregarious. It certainly makes you feel at ease and happy to be there making great music with him.
Oh, what a cool experience. And I feel one of the highlights, if I was in your shoes, just meeting all these other great musicians, like the composers, the conductors, the spotlight artists that you guys have. What a cool thing to just kind of broaden your music world every day.
Absolutely. Renee Fleming is going to be doing the Strauss Four Last Songs with us next season, and I cannot wait. That is heaven on earth.
Her music and her voice is gold. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, right there with you. Right there with you.
But I actually want to talk about more about your art, specifically around the viola. For all those that may not be familiar with the orchestra, you know, and the section of viola versus violin, what is the main difference between the two?
Well, the quick answer and the glib answer is if you set the violin on fire and the viola on fire, the viola will burn longer because it's a bigger instrument, takes more wood. But realistically, think back to Glee Club or church choir, you have the sopranos, which are the first violins, alto, second violin, tenor would be viola, bass would be cello, and then the basso profondo would be the double bass section. So that's basically the string choir. And then we are, of course, embellished by the winds, brass, and percussion. God. Not sure they would put it that way, but that's how we think
about it. Hey, that's a great way to explain it. I mean, and I love listening to the viola. Actually, I play the oboe, and one of our alto versions is the English horn. I actually, when I played the two of them, I really loved the English horn because it had this really rich lower sound. And I think that I feel the same when I hear the viola play. And in fact, I wish I heard more of the viola solos, so I can hear the sound because it's so rich and beautiful. But
absolutely. A lot of the lines are interwoven with the English horn and the viola section. So yeah. I like to compare it to the violins would be like milk chocolate or white chocolate, and the violas are more dark chocolate.
The rich chocolate. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, lucky for us, today we're actually going to hear you play, which you pre-recorded a beautiful solo. So I'm excited for everyone to hear that. Tell us a little bit more about the solo piece that you're going to perform.
Sure. So, I mean, the piece chose me just as much as I chose the piece, but we're in a period of physical distance from our audiences and our colleagues. So I'm playing Moon River for you all specifically today because it's sort of a wistful, melancholic tune talking about being across a river that's a mile wide from things you want to get to. And I think mm-hmm. we're all just can't wait to be back on the stage of Davies Hall sharing what we do. It's not just a livelihood, it's our lives with the audiences mm-hmm. that we love.
That's awesome. I love this song. It's so peaceful. You guys, let's listen in to hear Matt play this special song. So much, Matt. It brings peace to my heart, and it's so beautiful. And you actually kind of improvised some things on your own and added to that song, right?
Totally. It's a simple melody at heart, and I think they were thinking about removing it from the movie Breakfast at Tiffany's, and Audrey Hepburn said, if that song goes, I go.
Oh, so glad.
It's a heart string puller, no pun intended, and I can't play Bach and etudes and scales all the time. So it's nice to mix it up and see what I can do as an improviser.
Yeah, so true. I'm curious, do you actually play some pop or hip hop music on the viola?
You know, when I'm requested to, I have arranged it, but I have to do an oral dictation from like a YouTube video. Going into the Children's Hospital or Raphael House, even the Institute on Aging, we get special requests. So that takes a bit of extra work on my part. That's not my area of training. I grew up playing bluegrass and fiddle type music. So that's a stretch for me, but I can do it if on demand.
No, you're good. It's bluegrass, man. You're speaking my roots here, being from Oklahoma. That's the good old stuff. Let's do it. Let's do like a hoedown, Matt. It'd be fun.
Love it. Orange Blossom special next time.
Let's do it. That'll be fun. So my last question here, you know, on Behind the Curtain, we like to do just that. And this is really going in and finding out more about musicians or art forms that we may not know. So what I want to go a little bit deeper on is your career, of how, you know, sometimes we hear the beginning of a story from, you know, kind of your roots in Kentucky to now you're at the San Francisco Symphony. But I'd love to hear a little bit more about the process of, you know, kind of where you went to school and the trainings. For all those that are looking to do something similar like you.
Absolutely. So I, of course, learned from my mentors and they learned from their mentors. We all need a leg up in this profession as far as just things that people have figured out over the years with technique and the way the instrument is used and can be maximized. Plus, there have been innovations in the instrument itself. My instrument's 248 years old. So,
what?
Yeah. It's fun to think about that I'm just one person along the life of this much older entity.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, wow. my teacher in Cleveland, Bob Vernon, is who I credit with my professional success. He really showed me why I was out of tune and had a bad sound and had bad rhythm and how to fix it. So,
hey, we all have to learn. See, everybody, it
Absolutely.
Doesn't happen overnight. It takes a ton of dedication.
And now that I'm teaching, I borrow heavily on what I learned from him. So, yeah, it's a great circle.
Absolutely. And I think that's just something to remember, right? Like, big dreams don't come overnight. It takes a lot of practice. It takes, you know, this dedication and you to constantly revisit your motivation of why you chose the goal. And I want to talk to you about that, maybe, Matt. What has been something that you've gone to continue to stay motivated and play throughout your entire career?
That's such a great question because I do have an answer to that. I think about that a lot lately now that we have time to look inwards. And what classical musicians, but I think especially string players and maybe oboists, what we do is endless. The pursuit of perfection is what we are striving for, but the acknowledgement that live music is always different and it's a dynamic situation where things will go wrong. And in some ways, those are the more memorable or personally meaningful performances. But I think the fact that perfection is pretty much unattainable. And I think most artists would agree with me on that. I would much rather hear an emotionally impactful performance with flaws than a, you know, perfect antiseptic performance.
Mm-hmm. I absolutely agree. I think just an example of that is jazz. If you sing the same kind of Frank Sinatra's tune every time, I'd be like, oh, but when you kind of switch it up and put your own personality into it, and I'm sure you do this in classical music when you're doing your performances, it is the same music, but the way your dynamics are different or how you hold a note longer than maybe someone else did, it has this different story that you get to put a spin on it, which is really cool.
It's a real amazing thing. I think I always like to think of a school of fish, and the symphony moves like a school of fish, and depending on what one person does one night, even three nights in a row of the same piece or four nights as we typically do, it can be completely different from one night to the other. And that's where the magic is. It's not just the written notes on the page.
Absolutely. Okay, so thinking about all these pieces, you just mentioned four times, sometimes a piece. How many pieces of music do you perform a year? How many concerts?
210 concerts, I think, was the last count. This year, of course, is adding up a little differently, but 210 on average is what the San Francisco Symphony does.
That is nuts. Nuts. And on average, you know, when you got a new score of music, how often, like, how much in advance do you have to prep for a piece like that?
Depends on the week. If it's a Carl Nielsen Symphony, I'll be practicing it for months, but if it's Mozart 35, which we've all played a lot as auditionees and professionals, then you don't practice as much. But as far as rehearsing together, usually 4 to 5 times, and then we'll do the concerts. So
wow.
Every week it's new stuff. And if it's a movie week, we have 2 different programs. So a lot of material. I always liken it to, if you're thirsty, you take a drink from a fire hose and you're just like, it's a lot. So
Oh my God, you guys, there's so many things, like so many concerts to go check out. There's something for everyone. And Matt, last thing, what would be your piece of advice for someone who is striving to be a professional musician or a musician in some way, or, you know, an entrepreneur going after their goal, or even just someone that has a really great job trying to achieve the next thing? What would you say advice is?
Yeah, I mean, when I was an undergrad at the University of Kentucky, I never would have thought I'd be in the San Francisco Symphony. And I think the best advice I could give is just try to stay open-minded, keep your ear to the ground, listen to people you trust, and be diversified in your options. I know people who were more talented than I am, who are now in arts administration, or one of my classmates from the Yale School of Music is a lawyer now in Minnesota. Another is now a doctor at Johns Hopkins. She's in the emergency room there. So these, you know, I think highly focused people who study instruments can do anything. And just, I would say, keep your mind open and you never know where life's going to lead you. I never would have guessed I'd be playing viola in the San Francisco Symphony. Oh, talking to you.
I mean, I love that you are, and I'm so glad you know, you're in the orchestra. And that, you know, you're really right. There's, when I set out in my music career, I wanted to be an oboist and play in a symphony. And the more I did, I said, I love music. I love being around these musicians, that I want to help promote this to more people. And I actually worked at the symphony and now created Record Addict. So it's just, it's really interesting about just being open to the opportunities, see what, you know, where those are, and mold with it and kind of ride the wave, right?
Absolutely. We're in a dynamically changing world, and there's a need and a hunger for people who care about the art form in all aspects.
So cool. Well, Matt, thank you so much for joining us today. It's always great to chat with you. Cannot wait to see you again on this stage. And make sure to follow Matt on Instagram and check out what the San Francisco is up to, San Francisco Symphony is up to digitally, and what they'll be presenting this upcoming season. To check out our recent episodes, go to redcurtainaddict.com. You guys, we will see you next time.
Thanks, Carrie. Great to see you again.
Thank you.
Bye.